Fabulous. Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you ever so much for joining us all this evening. We are talking about an issue that is very close to my heart and the heart of many people who will be speaking today. The topic is deterrence diplomacy, preventing conflict in our own backyards, and I'm really grateful to the Henry Jackson Society for pulling together this really important event. We have a number of panelists who are going to speak each for 8 minutes, and then in about 30 minutes we're going to go straight to Q&A. So please do use the chat function now to put your questions in. Put your questions in as the speakers inspire you and as they ask you and raise topics that you want to ask them more about. We have some really, really wonderful speakers, and the first one is the wonderful Bosnian ambassador to UK, Ambassador Vanya Filipovic, who is a very good friend and a heartfelt friend to the whole of the UK, and someone who will speak very clearly about what we're seeing on the ground in Bosnia and his government stance. Then we will go to Professor Kenneth Morrison, who's going to talk to us about the Western Balkan situation a bit more broadly. And obviously, as part of that, Bosnia is the heart, the key, although he may disagree with me. We shall have to wait and see. Kenneth writes really widely on these topics and served as special advisor to the House of Lords International Relations Select Committee on the Western Balkans. So he very much is an expert on this topic. And then we're going to hear from Professor James Gow, who's going to talk about NATO, Ukraine and the Balkans, and give us the kind of wider context from a more securitized perspective. He is Professor of International Peace and Security at the Department for War Studies and was an expert advisor and witness to the Office of the Prosecutor at the UN International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. So he very much is an expert in the history that we are facing a repeat of today. And then finally, we're going to hear, last but not least in any way, we're going to hear from Isabel Sorkins, who is going to talk to us about Russia-Ukraine conflict, its wide implications, what that's going to mean for us and what we need to learn. And just briefly before I hand over to everyone, I just want to say how grateful I am that everyone's coming to speak to us about this tonight. Deterrence diplomacy is a term that I've coined because if you look back over the last few decades, and if you look back most definitely over the last year and over the last 8 years with what's going on in Ukraine, the international community hasn't yet really embraced this idea of how diplomacy can be, in effect, a true deterrent, how we can use it to protect. And I think with what's going on in Ukraine, and I was in Bosnia and Ukraine in January, there is no question that people are feeling nervous on the ground. And I think all of us are worried that this is the most sensitive and the most fragile that the situation has felt like, really, since the Dayton Agreement was signed. And I think we all recognise that we have to have our minds focused on the Western Balkans, the conversations around sanctions and so on that are happening currently. Those shouldn't be without the Balkans featuring. We're all aware of the narrative we've seen. We all saw some appalling images back in January of Muslim communities being intimidated. And I myself saw firsthand the weaponization of language that's going on. So the use of the word Muslim as an aggressive term, sitting opposite the Republic of Srpska leader Dodik, you know, his language and weaponization of the situation. But ultimately, a lot of it boils down to individual leaders just trying to maintain power and control, but being happy to use terms and language and political techniques that ultimately put people's lives at risk. So I think we're going to have a really interesting conversation. This matters so deeply. So it's really great to have you all here. And I'm going to now hand over to the wonderful Vanya, who is going to kick us off.
Thank you so much, Alicia. Good afternoon, good evening, everybody. It's a real honor and pleasure to be a part of this panel, very important topic, especially as Alicia said, in the lights of the aggression of Russia against Ukraine. I'm really thrilled to be on this panel with such eminent names, and of course, in such a great company of you out there in this Zoom world. I'm going to get straight to the point. We don't have much time. We've been allocated about 8 to 10 minutes to speak. So let me just say that, of course, everybody in Bosnia and Herzegovina is closely following the situation in Ukraine with a great deal of concern. I think there are two main topics here of concern. One is a broader sense that anytime an independent sovereign state that is a member of the UN is attacked and invaded without a provocation, it resonates deeply with our own experiences of the 1990s, especially when such an attack involves indiscriminate destruction of civilian lives and infrastructure. There are several similarities in the Ukraine situation to that of the breakup of Yugoslavia and aggression of Bosnia and Herzegovina. For one, in both cases, a larger state with a superior military force has attacked a smaller neighbor under false pretext of security concerns or alleged mistreatment of an ethnic group by the central democratically elected government. In both cases, the aggressor's goals has been to subjugate the attack state through the overthrow of elected government and installation of a friendly regime, followed by either complete or partial territorial annexation by force. The final step is presenting the aggression as a fait accompli and compelling the international community to recognize the results of the aggression as a new reality. In Bosnia, that was partially successful thus far, but the attempts continue through other means. I surely hope that Ukraine will be spared the same unfair and unjust destiny. In both cases, the pretext for attack also relied on various forms of demonization, reducing the attack state and its people to a historical and social aberration. In Ukraine, that demonization included assertions that Ukrainians are in fact Russians and that their current government are neo-Nazis. In Bosnia, the pretext for aggression in 1992 was that the Bosniaks, or Bosnian Muslims, who comprise about 50% of the total population, are in fact Islamized Serbs and Croats, and they pose a threat of establishing a Sharia-based society that would subjugate non-Muslims and be a threat to its neighbors. A complete nonsense that, however, some outsiders have bought in. And the same Islamophobic rhetoric can be heard even today from those who continue to seek the dismantling of the Bosnian Herzegovina state. The second area of concern is that Bosnia and Herzegovina today could be further destabilized at the behest of Moscow in order to increase the pressure on the West, forcing it to draw its resources from already stretched lines of NATO-EU countries bordering Russia and Ukraine, and diverting them to the Western Balkans, thus increasing the cost and risk of West's assistance to Ukraine. Russia maintains various levers through which it can severely destabilize the whole region. Over the past 15 years, the level of Russian involvement in the Western Balkan region has steadily increased through their diplomatic engagement on both bilateral and multilateral level, primarily through the UN. For example, one example is vetoing a UN Security Council resolution on Srebrenica genocide, which was warmly welcomed by the Belgrade government. Also through military assistance, again, primarily to Serbia, intelligence collections and ops, attempted coup in Montenegro, through trade and investments, primarily in the Indian energy sector. As a result of these activities, I would argue that the level of internal turmoil and stagnation in the reform process and Euro-Atlantic integration of the Western Balkan states is directly proportional to the level of Russian influence in each state. Where that level has been limited, the countries integrated to NATO have received the candidate status for EU membership and experienced generally less domestic and international obstruction in that regard. Where the level of Russia's interference is greater, the process is more stagnant and the country is more unstable. Serbia, I must say, is a somewhat peculiar exemption as it openly pursued both strong relations with Russia and into EU integration, but declining NATO membership for historical reasons. Serbia was able to pursue this dual track primarily due to a very lenient view from some Western capitals that, despite its close ties with Russia, Serbia should be slowly but surely pulled away from Moscow's orbit into Brussels over time. Just how hard it is to get pulled away from Moscow's clutches is seen by Serbia's reluctance to join the UN General Assembly's statement condemning Russian invasion of Ukraine, which it did eventually under immense international pressure, but at the same time refusing to impose sanctions against Russia. The internal level of Serbia's stability will fully expose if the country is compelled to define its position vis-a-vis Russia and the West even more dramatically than it has so far. It's clear that Ukraine has changed everything and the dual track diplomacy doesn't appear viable any longer. In Bosnia and Herzegovina, the pronounced nationalist secessionist politics have been on increase ever since our country was admitted to NATO's membership action plan. Russia's once neutral view of the integration of the Western Balkans into NATO changed, and Moscow began nurturing stronger ties with ethnopolitical oligarchs and parties that would overtly or covertly stall the Euro-Atlantic integration process. In return, Russia offered those political, at least diplomatic visibility and backing, especially at the UN Security Council, and bilaterally, offering the political support, certain financial benefits, security, intelligence, and defense cooperation. Again, energy featured very prominently, especially gas. These elites include not only those who openly advocate against NATO membership, as is the case of the Republika Srpska entity, and their political elites. They used to support the Euro-Atlantic integration, but changed their mind about the same time that Russia changed its policy on NATO expansion in the Western Balkans. They also include those elites who on surface advocate Bosnia's membership to EU and NATO, but actively work against any reforms that would see their stranglehold on political power challenged. These elites sought and continue to seek deepening ethnic divide of our society and further cementing the ethno-territorial division of the country that would render it completely inoperable, further reducing its democratic capacity and the ability to lead sovereign domestic and foreign policies. Russia supports them in those politics of preserving frozen conflict, and they support Russia. In conclusion, Russia has sought to retain influence and relevance in the region by various methods. In Bosnia and Herzegovina, Russia has found an especially fertile ground in the Dayton power sharing scheme, which gives the ethno-nationalist political oligarchies with centrifugal aspirations the tools to resist reforms that will make country more stable and closer to EU and NATO integration. In return, these elites use available mechanisms to attempt positioning our country as neutral vis-a-vis Russia's aggression in Ukraine, but so far have not been successful. Bosnia and Herzegovina has joined all relevant resolutions condemning the aggression against Ukraine and supporting its sovereignty and territorial integrity. Nevertheless, Russia has been successfully outmaneuvering the West in Bosnia and Herzegovina, even though both EU and NATO have very strong military and diplomatic institutional presence enshrined in the Dayton Peace Agreement and the SAA. However, the EU enlargement fatigue combined with general lack of interest in the region manifested in the readiness of the Western powers to continually appease the demands and blackmails from ethno-political oligarchs with Russian backing have created a situation where the international deterrence to secessionism has been completely reduced, while the country's integration progress has stalled. For Russia, this represented a low-hanging fruit in terms of maximizing its influence while minimizing its exposure. They found similar opportunities around the world and exploited. I will end by saying that the West still has a limited window of opportunity to disable the security time bomb ticking in the Western Balkans region by reducing the Russian influence, by exposing their local political allies and refusing to give them further concessions. The policy of appeasement must finally stop because it only encourages destructive behavior in the long term. This political decision must be backed up with military force if necessary, but it is exactly why the UN's executive mandate to EU4 has been extended each year. Currently, the military force needed to achieve deterrence is relatively small and inexpensive, but its mission must be robustly defined. Deterioration of situation will increase the costs and risks exponentially. The long-term solution for the region's stability and progress is a faster integration in the Euro-Atlantic institutions. Ukraine has confirmed that, even though we knew it this whole time. Thank you, and Slava Ukraini.
Slava Ukraini. Thank you so much, Vanya. I'm now going to turn to Professor Kenneth Morrison, who, as I said, is going to talk to us about the Western Balkan situation more broadly. Over to you.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much to Ambassador Filipovic for a fantastic speech. I'm going to talk a little bit about the geopolitical context, but how it's impacting specifically on the region and what the risks are today. So, of course, as Ambassador Filipovic mentioned, the geopolitical push and pull in the Western Balkans has been happening for several years. Now, within that, Russia has consistently played the role of spoiler and at times more explicitly of disruptor. Now, this has primarily been reflected in Bosnia-Herzegovina, with the UN Security Council, where Russia played a very negative role in their conversations about Bosnia-Herzegovina. With regards to the High Representative, which of course Russia declares it does not recognize as anything other than a private citizen. Within the Peace Implementation Council, where Russia does not sign off the PIC communiques, there's always a footnote at the bottom of each PIC communique saying the Russian Federation does not agree with this statement. And of course, the attempted Russian-backed coup in Montenegro in 2016. Now, after the Russian invasion of Ukraine, tensions in the region have increased as the broader political geopolitical environment experiences significant flux and the pre-existing European security architecture is challenged. Part of the region, of course, is in NATO. Serbia, Bosnia and Kosovo are not, but Albania, Croatia, Montenegro, North Macedonia are. But many analysts, including myself, regard the region as quite vulnerable and a region that could be destabilized by Russia through proxies in Serbia, in Republika Srpska, the north of Kosovo, and to a slightly lesser extent, in Montenegro. In the 3 weeks since the invasion of Ukraine, divisions have become more pronounced in the region. Support for Russia. There are some elements in Serbia, Republika Srpska, and Montenegro, particularly from right-wing nationalist groups, and of course, regional chapters of the so-called Noćni Vukovi, or Night Wolves, motorcycle gang. As you know, Serbia is the only European country not to support the imposition of sanctions, and Belgrade is still being used as a transit air bridge, essentially, between Europe and Russia. Now, the Serbian president, Aleksandar Vučić, has committed to neutrality, although, as Ambassador Filipović mentioned, eventually Serbia voted in the UN General Assembly in favor of condemning the Russian invasion. Nevertheless, Serbian media, which is monopolized by Vučić, is largely supportive of Russia, and that continues unabated. With regard to Serbia and Kosovo, the ongoing EU-facilitated Serbia-Kosovo dialogue, or so-called normalization process, has stalled. It was always unlikely to make much progress really before the upcoming parliamentary and presidential elections in Serbia in April 2022, coming up next month. But the situation in Ukraine has again fueled tensions between Belgrade and Pristina, which have remained very poor for a long time. Kosovo's Prime Minister Albin Kurti has warned that Serbia may be pressurized by Russia to destabilize Kosovo or Bosnia. And interestingly, both Vladimir Putin and Sergei Lavrov have mentioned Kosovo or the Kosovo precedent several times in recent press conferences by way of a justification for the invasion of Ukraine. Indeed, the former openly claimed that Kosovars were going to Ukraine to fight against the Russian military. In Montenegro, the collapse of the Zdravko Krivokapic government and the establishment, hasn't yet been established, but the proposal to establish a minority government led by the Prime Minister designate Dritan Abazovic, means that Montenegro remains still in a political flux. It's a deeply divided society. There's a long political crisis, and that shows little sign of abating. Now, as a consequence of calls to create this minority government, there was a protest launch called the Blockade Against Betrayal. And the Blockade Against Betrayal, which was primarily led by the pro-Serb, pro-Russian Democratic Front, there were lots of Russian flags, anti-NATO chants. But interestingly, there were some disagreements within the ranks of the Democratic Front over the Russian invasion. Now, on a personal level, they might express support for Russia, but actually the party hasn't really taken a stand vis-a-vis the invasion of Russia just yet, other than they don't want to take a stand that will in any way damage relations with Russia. Now, on to Bosnia-Herzegovina. Well, of course, and we'll discuss this much more throughout the session, the threat of secession by Milorad Dodik has generated significant tensions in Bosnia-Herzegovina. Specifically around the 9th of January, 2022, Republika Srpska Statehood Day. Not many people realize that Republika Srpska was actually declared in the Holiday Inn Hotel in Sarajevo during a meeting of the SDS on the 9th of January, 1992. And they still celebrate that as Statehood Day. Now, of course, as was mentioned previously, there were incidents following the Statehood Day celebrations in places like Foča, Prijedor, Janja, Brčko in Bosnia itself, and then also in South Serbia, in Novi Pazar, in Priboj, in the Sanjak region. And, you know, the presence of diplomats from Russia and China was also watched with some concern because they had representatives there on that day too. Since then, Dodik, who has very close links to Moscow, has continued to threaten withdrawing Bosnian Serb participation from state-level judiciary, the taxation system, and even the army. Now, this, in effect, would be ripping up the Dayton Peace Agreement. The issue of imposition of sanctions on Russia was also a source of contention recently. Dodik claimed that he wasn't informed of Bosnia's tripartite presidency decision to impose these sanctions. And thus there are fears that Russia may use Dodik, who has insisted that Bosnia should remain neutral in the Russia-Ukraine conflict, to destabilize Bosnia. Additionally, there are also concerns over the demands of the HDZ in Bosnia for electoral reform that would essentially give Bosnian Croats their own electoral district. So while I don't believe in Bosnia there is an imminent threat of conflict and there's certainly little will among citizens, we can't exclude such a scenario. Much is going to depend on the situation in Ukraine and whether that conflict might become a wider one. Tensions certainly in Bosnia-Herzegovina and across the region are already higher than any stage since the end of the war in Bosnia and the signing of the Dayton Agreement. And Bosnia in particular is vulnerable to tensions caused by the war in Ukraine. It was quite illustrative at the weekend. There were two marches or protests that took place. There were rallies, one in Tuzla in support of Ukraine and one in Banja Luka in support of Russia. And that is illustrative, I think, of additional divides that this recent Russian invasion of Ukraine has caused. I'd like to talk about what lies ahead as well, but I think we're going to leave that to the Q&A session. That'd be an interesting thing to pick up the Q&A session. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
No, thank you. And I will come back to you with that exact question when we kick off. Over to Professor James Gausman about NATO, Ukraine and the Balkans.
Thank you, Alicia, and thank you to Vanya Filipovic and to Ken, who have left nothing really to say, but I'm duty bound to speak anyway. I have to say it would have been better to have stopped with the ambassador's presentation and then gone to discussion from it, which is not to disregard Ken's excellent comments. I'll try and make three points, but the fourth one before I make those is that in any discussion where Bosnia and Herzegovina is involved, I want to stress that Dayton was there to prevent armed hostilities, to stop armed hostilities, and it remains there to prevent armed hostilities. And whenever there is discussion and people talk about this or that and trying to change things, until there can be a consensual basis for change, and that's some way off, we have to think what the consequences of any other changes would be. Now, NATO, Ukraine, and the region, the first thing is that although, as with 1991-92, we knew a lot of what was coming, it's still a shock when it comes. And the similarities on so many levels are there. The narratives, the actions, the provocations, the rather limited use of armed force by a military that's not actually capable of achieving the goals that it wants in any kind of quick or sophisticated way, even though it made assumptions about what it would achieve, leaves us with a situation where we look at the two clear differences. And as I face the prospect that beautiful Kiev is going to become Sarajevo for the next 2 or 3 years, 30 years on, we need to think about the similarities and differences. And those clear differences, Russia has nuclear weapons, and what Russia has done is so transparent. You could look at 91, 92, you could say there are always kind of ambiguities, some uncertainties. We could know, those who knew what was going on, but there were grounds for gray areas and doubts, why some people might think there was any doubt. In this case, there is no real reason for any kind of a doubt. And that leaves us in rather the same situation that we had in 1992, 91, 93, which is a West that is concerned, is seeing something that is wrong, but is again trying to do all that it can to avoid doing some of the things that might in the end actually make a difference. It's perfectly understandable that Washington is taking the perspective to be cautious. The risk of Russian action with Putin in charge is serious when it comes to nuclear weapons and to other means. But there's a logic which says you can only go so far until you're prepared to take stronger measures of some kinds. Exactly what those are, how they will be, we can't say. We can hope that they won't be necessary, but as in all of these cases, hope very rarely takes you away from the underlying logic of the situation. And in that context, I'll move on to the one thing that the events in Ukraine have really reinforced, and that's the issue of territorial integrity. That's why data arrangements are important to Bosnia and Herzegovina. But it's why Kosovo is a question. And Ken mentioned this, that Kosovo has been cited as a precedent. It was already a precedent for Georgia. It was a precedent for the earlier elections in Ukraine. And looking to how anything could be done to shift the situation in Kosovo, and I'm not positive that there are ways that that can be done, may be one element in trying to adjust the perspectives and the narratives. But I suspect that Russia is so set on what it's doing that nothing much is going to make a difference for some time. But it's important following from that and understanding those relationships to see that the future of international engagement, which means the future of some Western engagement, Ambassador Filipovic mentioned UFOR. We also have the issue of the of KFOR and the UN missions and so on in Kosovo, will depend on Russian agreement in the Security Council. Those will all need to be renewed, and we have to consider what will Russian actions be in this disturbed and hostile environment. We may be looking at a situation in which the international engagement in the region will be challenged, and challenged at that formal high lawmaking level. And the third point that I kind of want to make, which I think probably echoes something of what has been said already, but I'd say it more specifically, is that Russia has had many fronts on which it can act and agitate. Had things gone well in the initial phase in Ukraine, and had the West not mobilized, there's every prospect that they would have gone on to Lithuania and maybe Latvia as well. There is every prospect that when it's a right moment, they can destabilize things in Kosovo or in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Last week, Foreign Minister Lavrov told Dodik to adhere strictly to Dayton, which of course can be taken in two ways, but in this context, I think it's a signal to say, do not move at this point. But in the past, the Russians have made clear that if certain lines are crossed, they will be there behind Dodik and the RS. And we can't avoid noting that Dodik goes to Moscow and talks to Putin far more often than pretty much anybody else, and certainly far more than he goes to Sarajevo. So that link is there to be established. In Kosovo, there have already been agitations and protests on both sides. The tension is building up. You can say that it's building up within the communities, but it's also building up in terms of direct disturbance, provocation, agitation. And that's a situation which is probably more likely to be disturbed than Bosnia and Herzegovina in the nearer future. But in both cases, a lot of concern for the trouble that Russia could cause. And in the heart of all of this is Serbia. Ken mentioned Vucic in between. The Serbian security forces are now heavily pro-Russian. For a long time, it was in between. Vucic himself may be walking a line, a delicate line, right down the middle of things. He knows that the best future for Serbia and for Bosnia is Serbia in the EU and the RS gradually being reformed as a result of that. But there's no prospect of that now for many years ahead, if at all. So we're left in a situation with many fragile elements, many difficult positions internationally, with what happens in one place, parts of the Western Balkans, and what happens in Ukraine, linked to each other in the read across and in the specifics of situations and patterns. And I'll finish just with one final comment on all of that, which is there's been a lot of talk about war crimes. War crimes clearly are being committed. How they can be taken forward is a big question, but probably at some stage they will.
Thank you ever so much. And finally, We are handing over, in fact, to Helena Ivanov, and I apologise because I misintroduced you to Isabel Sorkins because I hadn't seen that we had had you join us, which is wonderful. Helena is a PhD candidate in international relations at LSE, but she previously did an MPhil in political theory at the University of Oxford and holds a BA in politics in the University of Belgrade. And she's been very much focused on propaganda within the Yugoslav wars and a model for how you study propaganda, which obviously, as we know, as I said earlier, words are being weaponized and the use of propaganda as a playground by the Russians and Chinese and others in Bosnia is something that we are absolutely seeing. So it's great to hear from you. Over to you.
Thank you so much. And indeed, Professor Gao said that he was struggling to say something after the two speeches that we've had. I'm definitely in a rather difficult position myself, but I'm sort of going to try and synthesize the kinds of things that I believe are the crucial stuff to think about if we want to prevent conflict in Bosnia, and end with like two things that I believe we need to focus on. I guess I would start by saying that 2 months ago, I don't think anyone thought we were going to see Kiev look the way it does today. And I think that pretty much mimics how most people from Bosnia thought about Sarajevo just a couple of months before war happened. And then all of a sudden, the longest siege of a capital city in modern history, which is the siege of Sarajevo, began. It just happened. I believe the issue is that we often overlook precursors that are there, that are indicating that we're in a delicate situation, that are indicating that a conflict is possible. I believe that that was the case in Bosnia. I think even before the 6th of April, 92, when Bosnia officially becomes independent, which coincides with the official start date of the war, there were various incidents which were indicating that there was tension in the region, that there was a risk of that conflict and violence escalating. In particular, I think the conflict that beforehand exploded in Croatia was further serving as a precursor that countries with various ethnicities who have territorial disputes could easily escalate into a conflict. I think finally, and this is something where I touch upon something that I've studied, if anyone looked at what, for instance, national broadcasters were airing in the run-up to the Bosnian War, it was very clear that we were seeing hateful propaganda, which was aiming to spread misinformation with the aim of inciting violence within various communities. So I think the first step and the most important thing to consider are the precursors so that we can respond in time, so we can do things before things escalate to a point of no return. I think the issue further with Bosnia was that even when it became clear that it is a war, the response from the international community came too little, too late. Most notoriously is the response in Srebrenica with the Dutch bat who just stood and witnessed the worst crime that has taken place in Europe since World War II. And I think it is really important that when we witness these kinds of circumstances, we need to pay attention to precursors. And once the conflict escalates, we need a more united front and a more, more coherent way of responding to a crisis than the one we've seen in Bosnia. And then finally, I guess, and this is something where I agree with Professor Gao, Dayton Peace Agreement indeed was placed to stop violence, and it has been successful in doing so. But I think, and that's sort of where I arrived to the second important point, which is reconciliation. I don't think Bosnia has really seen serious reconciliation process. I think the Dayton Peace Agreement has not really brought cooperation between different ethnicities, functional political discourse between the representatives of these political ethnicities. To just give you an illustrative example, I used to be part of the Open Communication Organization, which basically leads debating clubs across former Yugoslavia. And one of the projects that we wanted to do was Istoria, Historia, Povijest, which are three different words, Bosnian, Serbian, and Croatian for the word history, because we wanted to create a common textbook of what actually happened in the former Yugoslavia. There was absolutely no political will for a project like this to happen. And there was very little interest for that to happen. And I believe that creates a society which very much mimics the kinds of things that Hannah Arendt talks about, where everyone gets to say what they think and you can do with people as you wish because you don't have a functional discourse between communities. Serbs to date refuse to acknowledge many crimes that have taken place in Bosnia. And I think that only further contributes to the tension. So I think when thinking about what we must do, one, we really need to focus on the precursors to a specific conflict and respond in time. But two, we also must carefully think about the reconciliation process, which really needs to go to the very last down individual and not just, organize macro projects which make it seem like we're doing something to reconcile people's differences, but actually do stuff very locally and very regionally, which will put different ethnicities in touch with one another. I believe that otherwise, if we don't do that, and I think we haven't really done that in Bosnia, we end up in this place where there is tension, there is no functionality, there is no cooperation. And then when something like the Russian invasion of Ukraine takes place, that really then further complicates the situation. Because Russia invasion of Ukraine really touches the two crucial debates that it really hits close to home to the region. On one hand, it raises the question about territorial integrity. And then on the other hand, it raises this question of Serbia, who is sitting in between West and the East and clearly has an impact on what Republika Srpska is doing, and obviously the rest of the Federation, which is more orientated towards the West. So what I would say should be the addition to the Deterrence diplomacy is pay attention to a conflict way before it escalates and try and prevent it from escalating. And then two, if we really end up in that unhappy position where violence has taken place and crimes have been committed, reconciliation process must go much further and much deeper than that has been the case in Bosnia. And I think I'm going to pause there because I can see that there are a lot of questions and I kind of want to have a fruitful discussion with everyone about this ever-pressing issue. Thank you so much.
Thank you ever so much. That was really helpful. And I think across all our speakers, we've definitely covered the depth. And it is a difficult subject. You always think there's not more to be said, but there always is. We've got some really good questions. So I'm going to read out questions and then if speakers can kindly acknowledge if they'd like to take it. But actually, I'm going to be very cheeky and actually ask the question from earlier. So Ken, where do we go from here? That was the question that you posted earlier. So first to you with that one.
Where do we go from here? I mean, specifically in terms of Bosnia-Herzegovina or more broadly? In terms of Bosnia, well, look, I think that was a really very important point raised about precursors. You know, in hindsight, we should have now seen quite early on what was likely to happen in Bosnia-Herzegovina. And actually, we should have seen it from about 1991 when the SDS walked out of the parliament building and set up their headquarters across the road in the Holiday Inn. We should have seen it coming, but you know, even Sarajevans on the 4th or 5th of April were sitting in cafes in Sarajevo while shots were being fired in Ilija, and they didn't believe the war would come to Sarajevo. And that's a problem that we all have. We don't think the worst is going to happen until it's absolutely imminent. So it's important to pay attention to this. I think there are a lot of negative trends in Bosnia-Herzegovina. We've spoken about them already, and of course we've been addressing this over months. My concern, big concern, is that there are elections coming up in Serbia in April. I think the rhetoric will really ramp up. I think Vucic will, who's almost certainly going to win the election, and the Serbian Progressive Party will win the elections in Serbia, but they're going to want to keep the right wing, who are as much of a threat to them as any other opposition in Serbia, on side. And I'm afraid the rhetoric is going to get quite fiery in Serbia. It depends again on the course of the war in Ukraine. But look, there are a number of scenarios that I think we have to consider. You know, would Serbia consider putting military in the north of Kosovo in the pretext that they're protecting Kosovo's Serbs? Or that Milorad Dodik announces a formal secession from Bosnia with the tacit agreement of Moscow or Belgrade and then sends, you know, Serbian soldiers and to keep the peace in Republika Srpska. Now, you know, that's just a couple of scenarios, but we have to be thinking in terms of what is possible and what we might do now to mitigate against those things happening, because I think we are in a very dangerous situation. And I think all of us have a responsibility to consider now what could happen and engage in some serious scenario planning around that.
Is anyone else who'd like to come on that? Go on, James, you're unmuted already.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize I was unmuted. I was also at that moment searching to show you something, but I won't be able to do that. Yes, but it's too late now to be thinking about the precursors. Yeah, Moscow was planning for 6 months. The decision was made on the 3rd of December. Yeah, it was clear what was going to happen. In the case of the Yugoslav lands and the war in the 1990s, it was also largely clear what was going to happen and the signs were there. And what I was quickly searching for, if you would allow me to show my screen, is a cartoon that I have from Bosanski Pogledi from April 1991. And I stress 91, not 92, because people could easily think 92 when I say this. And it's a picture like Belshazzar's Feast of the Writing on the Wall. And the cartoonist saw what was coming because he has a cartoon of people wearing crescent moon armbands and declaring Živela Država Bosanska Krajina or something like that. Yeah, the signs were there. What was coming was clear. The problem in all these situations is not whether the signs are there, but wishful thinking. People constantly wish and hope that while ever something has not happened, that there's a chance that it still won't happen. And of course, theoretically, that's true. But in a case such as Ukraine, it was highly implausible that it wasn't going to happen once the decision had been made. So I think, while we have this discussion, yeah, I don't know how we get people to see when things are there to be seen, but people very often don't. Yeah, I went through the whole of the Yugoslav lands in the spring of 1991, and almost everybody I encountered was saying, oh, there couldn't possibly be, there might be a bit of trouble, there couldn't possibly be a war. What happened in the 1940s makes it unthinkable. But then I also happened to bump into some people who were planning things. And when you know that there are people deciding and planning, then you know that we have to be careful. So it's kind of a very difficult kind of situation. I don't want to dismiss the idea of discussing the precursors, but now we're way beyond that. Yeah, that might be for another time, and I'm sure another time we'll have the same failings.
Thank you. Vanya, there's a question from Jimmy James about imposition. So he says that Mr. Kovic mentioned imposition today, and Jimmy says that he feels imposition is necessary in line with the tribunal verdicts and that they reflect this. He says, I don't suggest discrimination regarding rights, but there is a space around acts of remembering where imposition could serve us well. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
I'm not quite sure what kind of imposition Jimmy referred to here. Trying to read his question again.
Not to worry at all, don't worry. Jimmy, if you want to,
yeah,
if you can put in for clarification, Jimmy, and then we'll come back to you. Then there's a question from you and Grant about the international community, and I think he's essentially saying, you know, where are the international community on this? And we need to build up a wide community of democracies to support post-conflict emerging democracies. We need to deal with adjacent bullying big brothers. But then in conflict, with that question, we've actually got a question from Callum Christie, who says, the divide between the East and West is now near complete. So how do we move on forward from here? So I'd be interested in views from panelists about, and again, I'll go back to you, Vanya, to start. But yes, we need to build an international community, and obviously I've been doing a lot of work on that myself, a community of like-minded to focus on maintaining peace in the Western Balkans. But at the same time, that will entrench further divides between East and West. So where do we go from here and how do we move forward?
Well, I'll start by saying that I think one of the important parts of calculation by Mr. Putin to invade Ukraine was this assessment that the West was in a slump, that there was no unity, that it's hemorrhaging, not just as a global, let's say, political military power of nations, but that the ideology that the West promoted, the liberal democratic order, is wasted, basically, that something else is going to take over. And I think you saw signs of rising China challenging US and the West through various means, both military, economic, with its soft power, hard power approach, you name it. And he saw what was happening probably during the Trump years, the challenges to NATO, to transatlantic alliances, transactional nature of alliances and deals and so on. And I think there was assumption that this was a permanent decline of the Western influence, both in hard and soft power terms. And that was probably one of the reasons why he's thought that he would not face the kind of reaction that he did, and I think all of us are positively surprised by the level of unity across the board. I mean, I read somewhere that recently a Bosnian, I think, written that if Bosnian government in 1992 had the 10% of the support in terms of military assistance, sanctions and media access that the Ukraine had, this would have been a different and much shorter war. But we are where we are. And I think we must collectively think about what kind of world we want to live in, especially smaller nations that feel especially vulnerable right now. And I'm singling out the Baltic states at the moment and other countries in that area, but there are countries like that everywhere. And I think we have to reinvest into this order that is based on international rules and regulations, imperfect as they are, and alliances, imperfect as they are. Look at the EU. I mean, it's a huge bloc, but it's a club of 27 countries, every one of them with own interests and concerns, etc. Yet, very much when push comes to shove, come together and formulate a very strong response. I don't think we have any choice. I don't think the divide between the East and West is permanent. I think we can work on it again. This is a battle of ideas. It's a long-term battle. I think we have lost some of the steam that was present, and we have wasted many opportunities, especially since 9/11 onwards. But I think this is not irreparable damage going forward.
Thank you, Vanya. And there's a few questions about sanctions. I'll just quickly touch on those. So people asking whether or not we could do sanctions. The new government sanctions regime that we have just brought in specifically allows us to sanction in the Western Balkans and in other places like that. That was a question I asked the Foreign Secretary when she was drawing up the legislation, and then again confirmed when it was raised with her at the Foreign Affairs Committee last week. Helena, question here, which is bang on for you, which is all about what assessments have been made regarding the spread of disinformation and how that will exacerbate atrocity risks around the elections later this year. And then I'd like to open that question up more broadly to the rest of the panel around elections, because there's a long way to go between now and October and how we get elections across the line, and lots of actors saying that elections shouldn't happen, a lot of actors wanting it to entrench ethnic divides. It'd be really good if anyone after Helena spoken could just raise their hands and give their views as well on how we make sure we get to elections, we make sure they go ahead, and what needs to happen before then. Helena, over to you.
Thank you. I think there have been multiple different assessments of, you know, performance of media and what media does in atrocity and the role that they play. Personally, in my research, I was fascinated to what extent certain misinformation that has been disseminated during the 1990s actually had an impact on people's perception about the legitimacy of violence. To give the most notorious example, at one point, the radio and television of Serbia in November of 1991 aired news that 40 Serbian babies have been executed by Croatian forces in the town of Vukovar, which in the end turned out to be fake news picked up from a journalist from Reuters that RTS has aired multiple times. Retraction, which I've been struggling to find, has allegedly been published in After Midnight News. It has become widely known, I guess, amongst academics and certain kind of people that this is indeed fake news. But when I went on the ground to speak to people, to speak with direct perpetrators of violence, you would be surprised how many times I've received this exact story as a justification as to why people decided to join certain paramilitary troops or decided to go to the war in the first place. And when you couple that with the legacy of World War II, oftentimes direct perpetrators of violence would tell me stuff like, well, they used to kill us in World War II. Now they've executed 40 Serbian babies in Vukovar. We feel endangered. We feel very threatened. And I would say that this kind of power of media is not uniquely related to war and conflict. I think it's omnipresent in every single setting. And I think it is exactly what we're witnessing right now. And I think one of the very big struggles that's often mentioned in Serbia and in the run-up to elections in particular is that press is not really free in Serbia, is that there is no actual balance between various political parties and their ability to speak out loud. And I think one of the crucial things that the Western Balkans as a region has to really carefully think about is media legislation, media balance, and freedom of press. I think that's ever more important, not just for Serbia given this election or Bosnia given the crisis that it is at the moment. I think it's an omnipresent problem of this region that needs to be addressed as a matter of urgency.
Thank you. And I think it's a real shame because there's a lot of people talking about the fact this is the first war, what we're seeing in Ukraine, that's been fully on social media via videos and citizen journalists. And that's not true. Syria, there was. It's just that nobody wanted to pay attention. But there is absolutely the recognition, finally, that information and language is a weapon system, and it's a very cheap and effective weapon system. And so we absolutely have to be paying attention to where we might see weapon systems being deployed to pre-arm areas where we could see further intervention. James, you want to come in on the elections point?
Actually, I wanted to come in on the information point, but I can extend it to elections. The information issue is not new. The information issue was a very big one in the course, apart from anything else, of the Yugoslav war. It was central to the initial Slovene strategy. It was central in a very different way, playing victim to Croatian strategy for many years. And it was certainly a key feature of the Bosnian government's strategy. And the Bosnian government strategy and the Croatian, but it was less noticed because there were fewer direct observers, actually brought it some problems. And that's because at times there would be the understandable plaintive cries of people who are largely victims to play on that and to suggest or to create things that would add to that sense. What we have, and it's perfectly understandable, but it's problematic and in the end wrong. And I think one of the key things now for Ukraine, and we've seen Zelensky's brilliant use of his 30-second to phone videos in contrast with the ponderous televisual images of Putin and his long tables, not allowing anybody near him because he's too scared to have anybody near him, whether for COVID or for other reasons of physical difficulty, is a great sense of the image. And it's very important for Ukraine and those who are with them now to make sure that information is accurate, to make sure that there are no inventions, that there are no distortions, because the biggest thing in many ways they have on their side, apart from spirit, obviously, is truth. The moment that they allow any distortion of the narrative, they allow anybody to say, oh, that can't be believed, this isn't true, they will begin to undermine the coherence of their own position and possibly the coherence of support elsewhere. And so I want to say, in terms of these measures, and the contrast with the complete fabrications from the Russian side will remain all the starker the more that the information coming from Kiev and from the Ukrainian forces and peoples is spot on and accurate and not in any way trying to deceive and distort. The question of elections, people will calmly move forward to elections. There will be efforts in some places to disrupt. Kenneth knows far better than I about the Russian-Serbian, but Russian plot to assassinate the Montenegrin president to prevent and disrupt the elections there. Yeah, there may be these things, but the important thing is the elections go ahead, whatever the difficulties, whatever the challenges, whatever the disruptions.
Great. Ken or Banyas, anything you want to say on elections?
Just to add to James's point about the elections in Montenegro in 2016, actually what alleged Russian interference in those elections in 2016 and an alleged plot to assassinate Milo Djukanovic will ultimately lead to more NATO in Montenegro, more support for NATO. It might even lead to the return of Milo Djukanovic, who's currently still president, but it appears that more and more the DPS are looking like a viable political alternative again, 2 years after they were voted out in the October 2020 elections. I think that it is going to be a tense time moving towards the October 2022 elections in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Anyone who's watched or just flicked through the television channels while in Bosnia, and you happen to come across Radio Television Republika Srpska, and you know channels from Sarajevo, they're completely different. They're parallel universes. You know, they have a completely different interpretation of the war, of history, of Bosnia-Herzegovina as a state. You know, those divisions have always been there, and they've always been to some extent weaponized. And I think, obviously, it will be probably a difficult period around the elections this year, but I do believe that the elections will take place. Of course, the outcome of the elections, and we know from recent history in Bosnia and Herzegovina, even after the elections have taken place, it often takes a very long period in which to form a government thereafter. So I expect a period of a little bit of flux after the elections have actually taken place. There is a question about sanctions, and I wondered if we should address those, that question before we
end. Anybody mind if I just say one quick thing following what Kath just said about the RS and media?
Please, John James.
Which is that, just to illustrate, in one part of research we were doing, we were holding focus groups about visual images and war crimes and prosecutions. We were showing things that were very well known to many of us and shown in the courts in The Hague. And the focus group we were doing with young people from the RS, they had never seen any of the images that are so well known in other places. They were completely in isolation. So I think we always have to keep in mind that the broadcasts are shaping people, but also they also play to the markets and the audiences that are there.
Absolutely. And Ken, I touched on sanctions earlier, but if you want to quickly add something before I go to Vanya to wrap us up.
There was one question about whether, I think it says, with Dodik launching a dismantling of BHS legal order, partners, should they stand firm against this attack and impose meaningful consequences if they are not reversed, with Europe having now demonstrated at last sanction power? I'd be very interested to hear what others have to say about this. I mean, my view would be yes. I think certainly any move towards, certainly withdrawing Bosnian Serbs from the army of Bosnia and Herzegovina would have to be met with sanctions, with some kind of sanction from the West. That simply has to be done. There are some sanctions in place, particularly from the United States, but I think we would have to take a much tougher stance should that be the direction of travel.
Apologies, my internet cut out for a moment. No, I agree entirely in terms of direction of travel. I think, as I said, the UK system has made sure that we are set up adequately. And we all know that Milorad Dodik raised over 300 million euros on the London Stock Exchange in 2021. And that is something he's incredibly proud of. And we should be looking at whether or not we should be allowing people to fund their debt who are secessionist states from within our own country. So there are lots of conversations going on internally. I'm aware we've only got 1 minute left. Vanya, I'm going to turn to you for any asks you might have of those listening today about how they can support your country, and any final comments you might want to say, as again, we all look forward to the election.
Thank you so much, Alicia. I don't have any ask except to convey that the Bosnia-Herzegovina, majority of people living here, and I'm dialing in from Sarajevo, as a matter of fact, they want to have a normal functioning state. They want to have a government that provides services to the citizens. They want to be part of Europe. When Bosnians immigrate, regardless of their ethnicities, they immigrate towards the West. They don't immigrate towards the East. So they want to be part of EU. NATO provides us with the security umbrella. That is why that is our number one foreign policy goal, to join NATO. This issue has been even more now important with the events, unfortunate events in Ukraine. So we are asking support on that Euro-Atlantic path. It will create security. It will resolve many outstanding issues. It will provide stability and prosperity for all the people, regardless of ethnicity, religion, etc. So any help on our way to that goal would be most appreciated. And thank you, Alicia, and the government, United Kingdom, for supporting us.
Thank you. Well, look, thank you ever so much to the Henry Jackson Society for hosting our discussion this evening. But the biggest thank you, of course, goes to our wonderful panelists, to Helena, to James, to Ken and to Vanya, but also to everyone who has tuned in this evening and taken the time to talk about this really important topic that we want to keep having conversations about, and we will. So there'll be many more Henry Jackson Society events in the weeks to come. Do check out all their channels. In the meantime, I wish everyone a lovely evening and thank you ever so much for coming. And as we all said, Slava Ukraini, I think, is very much in all our hearts. Thank you all ever so much. I hope to see you again soon.